the coming land.
Proclaim the coming.
And we will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. From every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the
speaking to me, breathing word after word of kingdom come. Here at your feet I can see the unseen truly. One look at you and I'm undone. I run to the throne room, I run to the throne room, and I fall on my face with angels and saints, and all I can say is, holy, holy, holy are you, God. My heart can contain the weight of your name, and all I can say is, holy, holy, holy are you. Grace upon grace, oh my fears fall away. Only your perfect love for me remains. Time after time you stay close by my side, burning fire inside I can't contain.
So
Father of life, draw me closer. Lord, my heart is set on you. Let me run the race of time with your life unfolding mine, and let the peace of God let it ring. Oh, Holy Spirit, you're my comfort. Strengthen me, hold my head up high, and I'll stand upon your truth, bringing glory unto you, and let the peace of God let it reign. Rise up within me, let me know.
holy God, and I am looking for a holy people, and I am worthy to inhabit your praises. I love you, my people, and I have called you.
Mama.
You cannot earn my love. You do not deserve my love, but I am a God of love, but I am also a God of justice. And I've called you a new creation, and the old has passed away. But you must say rubbish to the old. You must surrender and yield and let me have my way with you. Because I am the potter and you are but the clay. I want to rule and reign. I want to take over your hearts. I want whole hearts, not divided hearts. I want hearts that seek me and long for me. I want hearts that thirst after me. And I will fill that hunger and thirst if you will come. If you will yield to me. If you will let me have my way with you. I want to penetrate your being. I want to saturate you with my love. That my love will spill out all around you. To those that are broken. To those. We are living a time of a broken, hopeless world. But you have hope. You have the hope. I live within you. I am the hope, your hope and glory. And I call you out to come. Do not hold me back. But I want to work on the inside. I want to heal the inner person. I want to heal your hurts and your pain. I want you to let go of unforgiveness. I want you to let go of hate and anger. I want you to let go of the past and walk into my future. For I hold your hand, I hold your time. And I am the author and the finisher. But you must trust me. You must look to me and fix your gaze upon me. Do not look to the right. Do not look to the left. Do not let circumstances govern. Do not let them govern who you are and what I have called you to do. For you have an enemy that it is out there. He wants to snatch and steal and rob and take away your purpose. But come to me.
Silence, your love,
that makes you stand in silence. Your love, your love, and it's your kindness, Lord, that leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is on high, and it's your stand in silence. Your love is better than life. We thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you for your kindness, Lord. That leads us to repentance. Your favor, Lord, is our desire, Lord. It's your beauty, Lord, that leads us to stand in silence. Your love, your love, is better than life.
Amen. Good morning. Just one more commercial. Get your daily bread. The daily bread for June, July, and August has come in. They're on the back table here in the sanctuary. We have sufficient ones for every family to have one. Kathy and I do this every day, and it's a really, really good devotional. It's short, sweet, and to the point. So get your daily bread. And we're going to pray and dismiss our children for Children's Church, and we're going to get right into the Word this morning. Father, we just bless you and we praise you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the children of this ministry. And we ask, Lord God, that your presence will be made known to them in the children's church room, in their classroom. Father, that they will have fun in learning more about you and growing closer to you. We ask that your anointing would be strong on the children's church this morning. And we praise you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Children, you are dismissed for Children's Church. And why don't you just stand and greet one another for just a moment? We haven't done that for a little while. Greet one another for a moment. All right. God is good. All the time. We have a real privilege this morning. A faithful friend of Grace Christian Fellowship for many years, Mitch Foreman, is here from Chosen People Ministries. And introduce him to you. Some of you may not know him. Most of us do. And you're always welcome here, Mitch. Just to let you know, he has a table set up with his books and books from Chosen People Ministries out there. He's more than willing to meet with you after the service and to talk with you about the Chosen People Ministries. I'm sure he's going to share some from the pulpit as well. I've read a couple of those books, and he just handed me another book that I get to read. And it's good stuff, There is also a basket on his table that says Chosen People Ministries Offering. So that's where we take an offering for those who come to minister to us. And that basket is there for your offering to go to. And they make the checks out to Chosen People Ministries, correct? Okay. So if you give by cash, they'll take the cash. If you want to give by check, they'll take check. All right? And but make it out to Chosen People Ministries. And let's really, really bless Chosen People Ministries this morning with a good, good, hearty offering. Amen? Amen. Amen. Okay. Mitch, we welcome you to the pulpit here at Grace Christian Fellowship, and we are always blessed to have you, man.
Thank you. Yep, I'm on. Thank you, Matthew and Kathy, for inviting me to come back. Six times I've been here, Matthew. So do I get you know how they give people an honorary PhD? Do I get an honorary membership from being here?
PTSD here.
Well, it's good to be back here in the pulpit, and as most of you know who I am, I'm Mitch Foreman. I'm the Vice President of Chosen People Ministries. I grew up in a Jewish home, and when I was 28 years old, I accepted Jesus as my Messiah and believe that it's in the plan of God, which we're going to look at today. Because we're going to talk about mysteries today concerning Israel. Okay? Lots of mysteries in the world. Amen?
Amen?
Like, for example, does the Loch Ness Monster exist? We don't know. They've been looking for this thing for how many years? And they can't find him. How about Bigfoot? Right? I just saw the other day, ooh, somebody spotted Bigfoot. Right? Did aliens visit the earth? Who built the pyramids? Why are they so like you can't even put a piece of paper in between the bricks? We couldn't build the pyramids today, but they built it along. So these are all kind of mysteries, and they're mysteries because they remain unresolved. We do have mysteries in the Bible, okay? But the word is more hidden, because God has an answer to these. How many of you like reading mystery novels or watching it on TV? How many enjoy going to the back page, reading who did it first before you begin reading? None of you? Oh, I'm disappointed. You know, growing up, I grew up in the 60s, and there was lots of TV shows about murder mysteries and stuff like that. My favorite? Columbo. Because you know what Columbo did? He showed you who did it first. It's like reading the last page of a mystery, correct? And then the whole premise of the show wasn't how or who did it, but how Columbo was going to catch him. And that was pretty cool, because that show was on for many, many, many years. Now, I know what you're thinking. Mitch, how does Columbo have anything to do with Israel? Well, I'm going to explain it. Two. One, Peter Falk was Jewish. Did you know that? Yes. He grew up in New York City, moved outside of Long Island, but he was a Jew. Okay? And I think that he understood other Jews. I think he even understood Paul. Okay? Because their mannerisms were kind of the same. You know what I loved about Columbo? Is he was very annoying. Because he would always go and pester the person that he thought was the person. And as he was leaving, he would go, oh, I got one more question. Okay? And that's kind of, listen to this. This is now a quote from a fictional TV character, but it kind of surmises what we're going to talk about today. He says, I worry. I mean, little things bother me. I'm a worrier. I mean, little insignificant details. I lose my appetite. I can't eat. My wife says to me, you know, you can really be a pain. So that's the wife of Columbo, who is talking about this pestering man who seemed to always get it right. Why do I bring that up? Because as we turn to our scripture today, the book of Romans, anybody know who wrote the book of Romans? The Apostle Paul. Was Paul Jewish? And Paul always seemed to ask questions too. And just when you think that Paul is done teaching, he seems to want to ask some questions. If any of you have ever read the book of Romans, it's very systematic. Paul is a Jew talking to the church in Rome, predominantly non-Jewish people. And he wants them to understand the mystery of the plan of salvation. So he lays it out. He lays it out that the first thing, if you want to understand salvation, you have to understand about sin. Because for you to be saved, for there to be good news, there has to be some bad news. The bad news is we all sin. Okay? What's the good news? God can save us. And then once you're saved, then Paul starts talking about a tremendous opportunity that we get as believers, is how we get sanctified, how we get closer to the Lord in the process. And then the last part of the book of Romans deals with service. Every one of you should be serving God. That's his purpose. Your first purpose is to be reconciled back to him. Your second purpose is to try to figure out what God has called you specifically to do. Can I answer that question? No. Do I know what I'm supposed to do? Yes. Because I spend time with God and I have a peace. I have a peace that I'm doing what God has called me to do. Do you have that peace? And if you don't, I might ask that you spend today asking God. Because I believe that he will fulfill that. Because I believe that God has a plan for every person here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, right between sanctification and service, this seems to be what commentators say, something that doesn't make sense. Why does Paul talk about Israel and the relationship between Gentiles and Israel and the Church of Israel? It doesn't seem to fit the narrative. Well, I disagree. As you're being sanctified and you're trying to figure out how to serve God, God says, don't forget about the Jewish people. They're part of the plan. And you need to figure that out so that you can rightfully figure out what God has called you to do. And that's what we're going to do this morning. And it seems like Paul is constantly asking questions in Romans 9, 10, and 11. He is asking about the relationship between church and Israel in the form of questions. Romans 9, 14. Why does God seem unjust? Romans 9:30, why are the Gentiles coming to faith in light of Israel not being coming to him? And why did Israel ever really, you know, not hearing the gospel? And it's kind of building up and building up. He's asking all these questions, and it's bothering him. It's bothering him, and it might bother some who are Jewish and some who are Gentile. And then as we come to Romans chapter 11, he's going to ask three main questions that we're going to answer this morning. One, did God reject Israel?
No.
Two, did God replace Israel?
No.
Three, did God remove Israel from his plan?
No.
Well, very good. But the world might disagree with you. And at times, the whole church disagreed with you. And Paul, in a sense, is telling the church from the beginning, from its inception, about things that they might do in the future, and he's warning them, please don't do that. He's giving them the last chapter, because it's bothering him. And it culminates in Romans chapter 11, verse 25. And if we could turn there. And this is kind of where we're going to have as our foundation to understand the relevancy of Israel and the Jewish people. For I do not want you, brethren, to be uninformed of this mystery, so that you will not be wise in your own estimation, that a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentile has come in, and so all Israel will be saved. He's given us a plan. Isn't that cool? He's telling us the end before we're even there at the beginning. And he wants a few things from you. And when I say you, I mean the church. And predominantly the church, even though there's Jewish people, predominantly the church is speaking to Gentiles. And here's what he wants you to know as you sit there in your pews, as you're sitting there in your home, as you're sitting there part of the church, what does this have to do with me? Well, I'm convinced that you can't serve God unless you get this part of the problem correct. Okay? And here's what he's going to say. First, to Gentiles, be informed of this mystery. Because he says, I do not want you to be uninformed. So if he doesn't want you to be uninformed, then he must want you to be informed of this mystery. And we're going to take a look at that. Two, he says, so that you will not be wise in your own estimation. Not only does he want you to be informed, he wants you to have insight, but not from your own understanding. Because from your own understanding, it might look like God rejected Israel. It might look like he replaced Israel and he removed them from the plan of salvation. And he says, I want you to have insight on how this all works. And then finally, he says, I want you to be involved. You don't sit there in your pews and just read. You need to be involved in this whole plan because that was God's whole intention. Amen? You know what one of the biggest mysteries was, especially for Jews and to Gentiles? That the Jewish Messiah was coming for both Jew and Gentile. That was a mystery. Back at the time of Paul, the Jewish people thought the Messiah is coming for who? For the Jews. To defeat our enemies. And how interesting that God always had a plan to save both groups. But he chose the Jew to go to the Gentile. Okay? And we're going to unveil this mystery, this hiddenness, because it's there. Okay? So the first one, has God rejected the Jewish people? Okay? So, what we're going to do is we're going to see that Paul answers this question as we start to drill down after verse 25. So I want you to read verse 28 and 29 with me. And this has to deal with, has God rejected the Jewish people? From the standpoint of the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. But from the standpoint of God's choice, they are beloved for the sake of the fathers, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. What he's saying is that from the standpoint of the gospel, the Jewish people rejected God's plan that the Messiah would come to die for the sins. So they're enemies in a sense that they've rejected the plan of God. However, they're not your enemy. He says God chose the Jewish people and it's irrevocable and it cannot be reversed. It's unconditional. Okay? And a lot of people, and even people in the church for many years, use this verse against the Jewish people. See? God rejected you and you're the enemy of God. And you see how that was bad for Jewish evangelism? Because if people consider you to be the enemy, they most likely aren't going to want to share with you the good news. And that's what happened. And to get even more insight into this, I want you to turn now back to Romans chapter 11. Because Paul was like Columbus asking a question. I say then, God has not rejected his people, has he? And what's his answer? God forbid, or may it never be. 11 verse 1. He says, I too am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected the people who he foreknew. What Paul is saying is, listen, if God rejected the Jewish people, why am I standing here as a believing Jew? God is working with the Jewish people, but it might not be how we see it. First part of that mystery is there's a partial hardening. Not a full hardening, but a partial. And what Paul is going to do is now quote a scenario from the Old Testament. Okay, it was Elijah. Elijah was battling against the gods of Baal and the priest of Baal. Okay? And he quotes, Lord, they have killed your prophets, they have torn down your altar, I alone am left, and they are seeking my life. But what is the divine response to him? I have kept for myself 7,000 men who have not bowed down to the knee of Baal. What Elijah was saying is, God, I'm the only one left. And God says, not so fast. There are others. Not a lot, but there's a remnant. And you know what's cool about a remnant? It's not all. It's a small piece. Okay? But a small piece can be a great light into the darkness. And then Paul says, in the same way, there has also come to be a present time, a remnant according to God's gracious choice. Paul understood that he was the remnant. Amen? The interesting part is we might look back, and as I grew up in a Jewish home, I was always told that Jesus is the Messiah for Gentiles, not for Jews. It's okay for Gentiles, but not for Jews. Because when you look in the church, there's no Jewish people there. So how could Jesus be the Messiah for Jewish people if there's no Jewish people there? So it's okay for Gentiles to believe in Jesus, but not Jews. Well, the amazing thing is God always had a remnant. He had a remnant in the Old Testament. He had a remnant, okay, based on Scripture. And he deals with this as we keep reading. Okay, but if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace is no longer grace. What then? What Israel is seeking, it has not obtained. But those who were chosen obtained it, and the rest were hardened. Now he's going to explain, what does a partial hardening mean? It's God's sovereign choice. Israel, in a sense, didn't have a choice in it. They're God's chosen people, but God chose to hide some things from them because of their hardness. But it's not full. Because look at what he says. Just as this is written, and this is taken from Deuteronomy in the Psalms, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes to see and ears to hear not. That's even taken from Isaiah chapter 6. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap and a stumbling block and a retribution to them. Let their eyes be darkened to see not and bend their backs forever. In a sense, God gave them a partial hardening because it was God's choice. It was his plan. Now, do I always understand everything that God does? No. I just know that ultimately it's going to come to fruition. Okay? Because God tells Isaiah, who will go for us? And you know what Isaiah says? One Hebrew word. Anybody know that Hebrew word? Hineni. Let me go. And he says, well, what message? And he says kind of the same thing. You're going to go to a people that they're not going to listen to you. And they're not going to see you, but still go. So just because people are hardened doesn't mean that you don't go. Because God has a remnant. And has God had a remnant in the Old Testament? Because how many Jewish people listened to the prophets? Not a lot. How many Jewish people listened to Paul? Not a lot. How many Jewish people listened to me? Guess what? I can sit there and say, just like Paul, I am a descendant of Abraham. God has chosen me. I didn't have a choice. He called me. And today, guess what? Do we see a remnant today of Jewish people who have come to faith, going back into Israel to tell them about who Jesus is?
Yes.
Absolutely. I'm very thrilled that you want to support our ministry. Why? Because I need your help. Because going to the lost sheep of Israel is very difficult. How do I know that? I'm Jewish. My whole family is blinded. Other than me, my immediate family, my kids, and my twin brother, daughter, who's come to faith. Okay? And it was very difficult for me to go back. She came to faith during a retreat that we had at Chosen People. And I had to go back and tell my brother, Mark, I just wanted to let you know that your daughter accepted Jesus as her Lord and Savior at one of our retreats. Okay, it was very, I had to tell him. I couldn't let somebody else tell him. Now, was my brother upset? Not really, but did he understand it? Not really. You know, did he want his daughter to be a Christian? Well, he probably wants her to grow up more Jewish. So what he did was he enrolled her in the Hebrew school to get her bar mitzvah training. And she went through it. And you know what happened during that time? My brother figured, well, maybe I didn't do enough to raise her Jewish. So let me do that, and that might supersede what, you know, Mitch and his people were showing her. And then she got a glimpse of both worlds. She'd see the Messianic world, and she'd see the Jewish world, and guess what happened? By being kind of involved in the Jewish world, her Jesusness increased much more, because they couldn't give her what she was missing. And to this day, she is a strong believer, and she is part of the remnant. So it's a partial hardening, but we are still here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, Paul says, okay, if God hasn't rejected the Jewish people, you might ask, well, has he replaced them? Has the church replaced Israel in God's plan?
No.
Well, hold on to your thought. Let's read now, as we go back to Romans chapter 11, 30 and 31. Paul's going to answer this question. Has the church replaced Israel? For just as you once were disobedient to God, but now have been shown mercy because of their disobedience, there means the Jewish people. So these also now have been disobedient, that because of the mercy shown to you, they also may now be shown mercy. Now you're reading that and you go, Mitch, what does that mean? How does that have anything to do with replacement theology? Well, what Paul is going to say is, if God showed you mercy, guess what your role is? To now show that mercy back to the Jewish people. Isn't that amazing? Because Paul talks about the church. You were so far removed from God, how would you have been saved if the gospel wasn't first presented to you? The Gentiles had no idea of a coming Messiah, did they? No. They had no idea about sin and salvation. They had no idea about the sacrificial system. They had no idea about any of this stuff. But guess what? God made sure that they would know. Why? Because the Jewish people, where did they go to? The Gentiles. Now, it might seem strange. God's plan is a little bit different than ours. Paul, what was Paul's role? What was his profession before he became a believer in Yeshua? He was a tent maker, but he had a very prominent position too. Most likely, he was a Pharisee. He's a rabbi. He's a learned person. So in our world, here's what we would do. Peter's a fisherman, right? Gruff, not learned. Hey, Peter, you go to the Gentiles because they understand your life better. Paul, you're a rabbi. You're going to stay in Jerusalem and you're going to try to, you know, get all of these learned Jewish people to come to believe. And God says, eh, that's man's way. I got a better way. I'm going to keep Peter here and keep John and all these fishermen, but I'm going to send the rabbi out to the Gentiles so that he has to sit down, eat a ham dinner, right? And try to explain to them the gospel. But how ingenious it is for God. Think about it. God said to Paul, I've called you as a rabbi to go to the Gentiles, because they would think that that's very strange. Why would a rabbi want to go to the Gentiles if it wasn't true? Right? I think it's one of the thorn of his sides. Might have been a physical, but maybe it always bothered Paul. Because when Paul went out, where was the first place he went to? The Jews in the synagogue. He always went there first, but somehow he knew God was calling him to the Gentiles. Did he completely understand it all? I don't believe he did, but he was faithful. And it worked, didn't it? I always wondered, why did so many Gentiles come to faith? You would have thought the message was very readily available to Jewish people. They should have connected the dots, shouldn't they? Oh, Jesus is a high priest. Oh, we have one of those. Jesus is a sacrifice lamb. Oh, we have one of those. Jesus died at Passover. Oh, we know about Passover. We know about all these things. And the Jewish people said, yeah, but the Messiah doesn't fit into our plan. And then all these Gentiles are given all of these points. And you know what they say? Hey, we believe. Why? Because God was trying to tell us something about the world that the world is still trying to tell us and we reject. The world says that if you have your own choice and you can do whatever you want, you will be happy. It's all about choice and freedom of choice, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can choose whatever you want because it's your body, it's your life, it's your profession, it's your right. And guess what we do with our right? Oh, like me. It's my right to get drunk every night and do drugs. Oh, but you didn't tell me I'd be addicted. Oh, I have every right to do this, but you didn't tell me that there would be consequences. And so what happens is we have this false premise that is not new, that your choice will make you happy. Well, if that's the case, why are there so many unhappy people? Why do we have an opiate crisis? Right? Why do we have so much, so many people going to therapy? Why do we have all these self-help things? Because people aren't happy. And God knows that. You know why Gentiles came rushing to the gospel? It works. Isn't that amazing? It works. There's no reason why Gentiles, who could do whatever they want, should have gravitated to the gospel, but they did. Isn't that amazing? They were unhappy because they understood something. They made choices and could believe in all these gods and do all the things that they wanted because there was no consequences, and they weren't happy. And that's what God is saying here. Why were the Gentiles grafted in? One, they weren't happy. They needed salvation. Two, just like God, it's his plan, which went totally against what we would think. Okay? Because he says there's been a partial hardening of the Jewish people until the fullness of the Gentiles. So how do the Gentiles fit into this plane of the Jewish world of salvation? Well, let's dig a little bit deeper in Romans chapter 11, because Paul says if they've been shown mercy, then they should show that mercy to Jewish people. And look at how Paul says in verse 11 of chapter 11. I say then, did they stumble so as to fall? Did they? And again, what does he say? May it never be. But by their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make them jealous. Think of that word, jealous. What does that mean, to make Jewish people jealous? Does that mean that you go up to a Jewish person's home and you drive your brand new like BMW in front of their house and say, hey, look what God gave me? No. See, that doesn't work with Jewish people. You know why? Because they lift up their garage and they show you three BMWs. Say, look what God gave me. It has nothing to do with monetary gifts. You know what it has to deal with? Your spiritual life. What most people in the church don't know is that very few Jewish people have a personal prayer life with God. I grew up believing a couple of things about God. One, he's much bigger than we are, and he's too busy running the universe to worry about little old me. So don't bother him with all your personal prayers, because it's not the way Jewish people pray. You go to a synagogue, there's a lot of prayers in synagogue. But we read a book called the Siddur. It's the prayer book of the liturgy of the service, and it follows the same pattern with the same prayers every week. Everyday Orthodox Jews say the same prayers at the same time for their whole life. That's how the Jewish world exists. There's one little section, though, of the synagogue service that there is personal prayer for, but it's about 2 minutes. We pray for those in leadership, and we pray for the armies of Israel. So I got my little G.I. Joe soldier here, because doesn't Paul say that we should pray for those in power? Whether we agree with them or not, they've been put there by God. Should we pray for an army? That's a very interesting question, isn't it? Should we pray for military assault? Well, I look at an army twofold. We have physical army and we have a spiritual army, right? We're part of God's army. And guess what our power is? The sword, which is the scriptures, and what to me is the fire in our belly is our prayer. You know how you can make Jewish people jealous? I wanted just to let that fester in. Because if you think about it, that should be part of the mission statement for every church. Paul says that if a Jewish person walked in here today, would they be jealous? It's a good question, isn't it? Right? Would a Jewish person be jealous of what you have today here as you worship? If they look at your life, should they be jealous of what you have? Man, that's raising the bar quite a bit, isn't it? Well, good, because I'm here to test you. Are you making Jewish people jealous? Are you doing what Paul has asked you to do? Well, the best way to make Jewish people jealous is to let them know what you have, which is something that most Jewish people don't have, which is a personal relationship with God. Why? Because Judaism has a false premise about the consequence of sin. Growing up, I was told that God has a scale and you try to tip the scale in your favor. And that's not just a Jewish premise, that's a world premise. Just trying to be good, right? Just trying to win favor to God. Look at God, I've done this, 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 and this. And, you know, we have a scale. The reality is that sin has affected all of us. What's the consequence of sin? You are separated from God. How do you get back to God? By believing that his son died for your sins. You know what's amazing? God says this to the church. Don't worry about saving yourself. You can't do it. I'll save you. I'll give you the most important answer to the most important question that everybody's looking for. Right? You want the biggest mystery in the world? What happens when I die? What happens? Some of you might be sitting here today asking that question and not having an answer. What happens when I die? Because if you believe in good works, then you guess what? You're not sure. You hope you've done enough good works, right? You hope. You hope in something that might not be true. So here's what Jesus says. Don't put your hope in a false hope. He says, let me help you. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So here's the greatest gift in the world. You have something that everybody wants. Eternal life. If I asked you, do you have to worry about where you go when you die? What would you answer me?
No.
No. If you have a hard time answering that question, then you might not understand the gospel fully. That's okay, because that's what we're doing today. The beauty of the gospel is Jesus says, let me take that away from you. If I take away that, then go live for me. Now go serve me, because we don't have to worry about where we go when we die. We are the most powerful army in the world. Because I don't have to worry about dying. My daughter, when she went on a trip to Israel, some fighting going on. She goes, Dad, should I be afraid? I go, no. Because what's the worst that could happen? You die and spend eternity with God. So we don't have to be afraid. So it makes us the most powerful army in the world. And how do we use this to make other people jealous? Because we get together and we pray. We get together and we follow God's word. We put into practice what other people are trying to do, but they don't have any power. Why? Because they're doing it on their own wisdom. Paul says, don't do that. Trust God's wisdom, who says, if you come to know Jesus, guess what you can do? You can pray. So if you really want to make a Jewish person jealous, then you know what you should do? Pray. Not just in generic terms. What I want you to do is, how many people here know somebody Jewish? Do you specifically pray for them? Do you ask them, should you pray for them? That's what I would like to ask you today. Don't be afraid. Because Jewish people, we don't call up the rabbi and say, Rabbi, my mother's going into the hospital. Can you pray for me? So here's what I want to challenge Grace Christian Fellowship with. Okay, as you come every week, and if you lift up prayers, I want you to lift up the prayers of Jewish people too. Why? Because if you have been shown mercy, don't you want the Jewish person to be shown mercy? And here's what you get to do. It's not only the right thing to do, but it's a plan. See, this is how smart God is. He's saying, Gentiles, I want you to be involved. You're going to make Jewish people jealous. And here's how you're going to do it. Ask your Jewish friend, can I pray for you? And you know what most likely is going to happen? They're going to say yes. Hey, my mom's going into the hospital because she found out she has cancer. And I'm very, very nervous. And then you know what you do? Right then and there, pray for her. Which I think everybody would agree. Israel, Jewish people, wherever they are persecuted. So guess what they need? They need a homeland. So from less than 25,000 people in like the middle 1800s, anybody know how many Jewish people live in Israel today? 5.96 million Jewish people. A third of all the Jewish people live, guess where? In Israel. They've come. Millions came from Russia. Millions came from other parts. Hundreds of thousands were kicked out of all the Arab countries when Israel came back. Okay? Guess where another third of all the Jewish people live?
New York.
United States. What's going to bring Jewish people back to Israel from the United States?
Persecution.
You go, oh, that would never happen. You know, the United States is a Christian country, and we're going to stand up for Israel, and we're going to make sure that anti-Semitism doesn't exist, because just think, it was only 70 years ago that a third of all the Jewish people in the world died, and now you're telling me that that's going to happen here in the United States? Well, we might never have seen it, but guess what? We're living in days when we are seeing it, aren't we? And we're seeing it from within, not without. Why? Because there's a war going on. And guess what? It not has only to do with the people, but it has to deal with the nation of Israel. See, this prophecy is not just about Israel and the Jewish people coming back to life, but Israel coming back to life. Everybody wants that piece of land, right? And it's interesting, and now we're going to see it even more. There's a spiritual warfare. Who owns the land? Is there a fight over who owns the land? And more people are starting to see that it might not be Israel. Okay, and the college campus is rampant with what's called BDS. Anybody ever hear of BDS? It's an acronym. It's a movement among young people to get colleges to boycott, divest, and sanction Israel because of their actions against the Palestinians. Okay? And we see that played out now in our Congress, don't we? Because now we have politicians who are taking a anti-Israel side, and we're going to see it more and more. Why? Because they believe the land should be theirs. So there's a fight over the land. And why is the land important? Because, well, God wants the Jewish people to have a land where they can all live, with him being their king. But before that happens, one of the things that I think that often gets overlooked in all of the prophecy and why Israel is relevant, not only should it be a safe haven for Jewish people, God wants to do something, and he can only do it in Israel. If everybody wants the land, maybe they can prevent God from doing something. And we're going to finish up on why Israel is relevant, because it's relevant to God. I want you to turn to Ezekiel chapter 38. Okay. And in Ezekiel chapter 38, God is speaking to Gog and the land of Magog. Now, there's always been much speculation. Who is Gog, a person, in the land of Magog, a country? Anybody here want to take a guess?
I think Gog is more towards the Antichrist.
Anybody else have a guess? Well, some people believe that it's Russia. And because, in a sense, Magog is coming from an area of the world called the Scythian nations. Those are all the stands. Kazakhstan and those, and it's part of the former Soviet Union. And they're going to assemble an army at the end, because he says in the end times, you will be called. And guess who comes with them? Who's modern-day Persia? Iraq. I mean, it's more Iraq. Iran is there, but Persia is kind of Iran and Iraq. Okay? Ethiopia. And some people place Somalia within Ethiopia. Put, which is Libya. Goma. Beth Togarmah. A lot of people put Turkey in that position. So imagine, this could never happen. Imagine the scenario. Israel's living the way of life, and Russia decides, yeah, we're going to talk to a few of our friends, Iran and Somalia and Libya, and we'll just kind of attack Israel. Well, we could never see that happening, could we? It could happen tomorrow. Okay, why? Because God says he puts hooks in their jaws. Why the hook? It's almost like God is fishing, but they think it's their own plan. And you know what they want? They want the land. And they think that they can come and take it if their army is bigger than Israel. And imagine if U.S. was no longer standing with Israel. Would that make Israel much more vulnerable? Yes. And guess what? It's just like God to do that, huh? One of the biggest questions that everybody asked me today, how come I never see the U.S. in the end times? It's a good question to ponder. I don't have an answer to that, but it very well might be because God wants Israel to be alone. Why? Because God likes those odds better. Because God has a plan, and this is how we're going to finish up. If you turn to Ezekiel chapter 38, verse 16, and he's talking to these nations, and you will come against my people Israel like a cloud to cover the land. It will come about in the last days. So that's how we know it hasn't happened yet. And when it does happen, if you see all of this scenario coming, guess what you should be thinking about? We are in the last days, because Ezekiel's telling us that. And I shall bring you against my land in order that the nations may know me when I shall be sanctified through you before their eyes. God wants the world to see something. Now, I take the position that this is a war right before the tribulation. Why? Because I believe God is going to show the world a little taste of what the end times will really be like. Isn't it just like God to give us a little warning and sign before the ultimate end? I think he's saying these enemies have one thing in common. They hate Israel, and they don't believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They're taking their stance, and he's saying, come. Because one, I want the world to know what I'm going to do. I want them to understand that in the end there will be judgment, and guess where God wants to judge these nations? In Israel. That's where his throne is, and that's just like a judge. The judge doesn't come to your house to convict you, does he?
No.
You go to his house. God created Israel for the Jewish people, but he also created it as a place of judgment. And a lot of people don't put this in the last days, but it's very important that we understand this. Why? Why would God do that? Because he has a very interesting way of doing things. Okay? And we'll finish up in verse 21. I shall call for a sword against him in all my mountains, declares the Lord God. Every man's sword will be against his brother with pestilence and with blood. I shall enter into what? Judgment with him. And I shall rain on him and on his troops and on many people who are with him a torrential rain with hailstones, fire, and brimstone. A lot of people even seeing this being almost a nuclear war. Okay, but here's why God is doing it. And this is always like God to do something that would be amazing, because from calamity, from judgment, guess what comes out of it? I shall magnify myself, sanctify myself, and make myself known in the sight of many nations so they will know that I am the Lord. God's doing it so that the nations will know who he is. Amen. So as we end, here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to just pray for the Jewish people today. I'd like to pray for all of those in our country who have given their life so that we could have freedoms, right? We all have freedom of choice. We don't always all make the best choices. May this church be used, I was talking to Matthew, may this church be used as a light to the community. You have answers that are better than what they have. We can help the community by offering programs and the building and the people to do things that they can't. So let me just send in a word of prayer and then I'll turn it back over to Matthew. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and King, I thank you for this message, Lord. It's a mystery. The mystery that you have hardened the Jewish people so that the Gentiles could come in, create the church to make Jewish people jealous. And then in the end time, Lord, you're going to start using the Jewish people. You're going to create a remnant. You're going to bring back the people to the land. You're going to establish the land for your purposes, Lord. So is Israel relevant? You bet. It's always been relevant because it's where God decided that he would speak to his people. So, Father, I ask a blessing on the nation of Israel. May you protect them. Lord, may you bring many people to Israel to help them, but we know in the end a lot of people will abandon them. But Lord, the church should never stand against Israel. You haven't rejected the Jewish people, you haven't replaced them, and you haven't removed them from their plan, but your plan is different than ours. Lord, we pray during this season too for our own country. A third of all the Jewish people in the world live in this country, and Lord, you said, I'll bless those that bless you. I believe that the United States has found a tremendous blessing by blessing Israel. And Lord, we ask that they would continue to do so. Lord, we get blessed by just making Israel our friend. But Lord, it doesn't mean that we forget about others. And Lord, we have, over the centuries, many people who have given their life for the freedoms that we have that everybody wants. And thank you, Lord, for creating the United States. One, my family, after the pogroms in Russia, found new life in the early 1900s in this country. And I thank you, Lord, for that, because without this country, I might not be standing here today, because many more millions of Jewish people would have died in the Holocaust. So, Lord, you use the United States as a sanctuary to protect a great remnant. And, Father, I thank you for that personally. I thank you, Lord, that it is a great nation. We have many faults, but, Lord, you have given us the right to choose who to serve and worship. May those rights always be protected. And as people try to whittle these away, Lord, the church is going to be pruned, and the church is going to have to stand up for what they believe, and that's your way of making sure that the church knows their rightful place and plan. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that this is still the greatest country in the world to share the gospel. May you continue to use the Christians to pray and help Jewish people come to know their Messiah. And Lord, continue to use Christ Fellowship in a way to be a light to Winchester, New Hampshire, and the greater region, Lord. They have resources. They have a building. They have people who pray. We want to give out stuff to people. We want to give out books. We want to give our space. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the leadership here. We thank you for their heart, and continue to make this a light to the world. And we pray this in the name of Yeshua. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Mitch, I love that last verse that you ended with. Thus I will magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations. Then they shall know that I am the Lord. You know what that says to me? God's going to have the last say.
Yeah.
No matter what goes on in this world, God's going to have the last say. Hallelujah for that.
Amen.
You know why? Because he's God. There is no other, and no one else, nothing else, no other spiritual being can possibly topple down our Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah for that. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord Jesus. You are the Messiah, the one and only. You've given us the privilege of finding you. I thank you, Lord, for Mitch and his love for you, and Chosen People Ministries to minister to the Jewish nation on behalf of their Messiah. Lord, we ask that your anointing will strengthen in these last days. And for each one of us, Lord, that we will purpose to spread the good news of Jesus Christ in every corner you give us to say. We praise you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. I know that Mitch would be more than willing to talk with you. He's got a book table set up. Take a look at what books are there. Buy some books. Please leave a love offering in the basket on his table. And if you give by check, give to Chosen People Ministries. God bless you. Let's stand. May God bless you and keep you. May his countenance shine upon you, and that his grace will fulfill your life.
Yes.
That the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guide your heart and your minds through Jesus Christ, the one and only Messiah. And in Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen.
Hang on. Because I'm going to say that prayer in Hebrew. So if you would just bow your heads. This is called the Aaronic Benediction. It's one of the oldest prayers in the Bible. And this is what it would sound like in Hebrew. Amen? Yivarech Adonai b'yishmarecha. Yireh Adonai panav alecha v'yihunecha. Yisah Adonai panav alecha v'yasem lecha shalom.
Wow. Not only can he play the shofar, but he can also preach, and the guy can sing. God bless you.